did include.
Hello and welcome to the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast, episode 244. One game to rule them all. Our favorite fantasy board games. Brought to you by our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild, and our fantastic Patreon patrons.
And the awesome people in the chat that just gave us a nice hype train to get us hyped and ready to go tonight. So tonight we've got a trio of fantasy game reviews. First up, two based on J.R.R. Tolkien's The Lord of the Rings. We've got the One Ring Roleplaying Game Core Rulebook and Shadows Over Middle-Earth, which is part of the Exit series of games from Cosmos. Then we got a third fantasy game with Tir na n'og from our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild. Since we are doing all fantasy reviews, I thought it would be fitting to also talk about our favorite fantasy games. So we're actually going to start with that. In between those, we will be sharing our first thoughts on Mare Nostrum Empires, Robot Quest Arena, and Oros, as well as talking about the other games we've been playing since we were last here.
Before we get to that, some introductions. I'm Sean, your host, and here with me, we have Anshi Games herself, Deanna.
Hey to all the cardboard connoisseurs out there.
And the tabletop bellhop himself, Mo T.
I am Mo Tuzano, the tabletop bellhop, your cardboard concierge, helping you make your game nights better.
Show up Wednesday nights at 8 p.m. Eastern at twitch.tv/tabletopbellhop to watch us record this podcast live.
And join the hype train.
You can find detailed show notes for this episode at tabletopbellhop.com, episode 244. That's 244. Links may be affiliate links, which cost you nothing extra to use, but do help support us.
Now, some of the games we plan on talking tonight were provided as review copies by publishers.
The Tabletop Bellhop is here to answer your gaming and game night questions.
Tonight, we're talking about our favorite fantasy games.
This is a bit of a follow-up to episode 231, The Final Frontier, which we released earlier this year back in February. And there we were talking about our favorite sci-fi games.
So check out that episode if you want to follow, hear about my favorite genre of games.
So let's get things started with a quick, at least I assume this one will be quick. I don't think it'll be like talking about classic games, but a bit of a discussion on what we think when someone says fantasy games. Because while fantasy can be pretty broad, and while some sci-fi is more fantasy than science, especially the one with the space wizards and laser swords. When I hear fantasy, though, I don't think of that. Like, yes, I could probably agree to the argument that it's sci-fantasy or something. But like when someone says fantasy to me, I think dragons, elves, dwarves. I think Tolkien and Dungeons and Dragons. Now, I also think there are types of fantasy that are kind of subgenres that I don't know if always fit when you're talking fantasy. Like for me, I don't think urban fantasy when I think fantasy. Like urban fantasy is a thing, totally a genre. I totally get it and I understand its appeal. But if you say fantasy board game, I don't think urban fantasy board game. Things like Changeling, Charles de Lint fit that urban fantasy thing. And I also really don't think horror mashes well with fantasy, though there, of course, can be horrific fantasy. So there's that bit of overlap. But like you mentioned vampires and zombies, even if I'm playing Ravenloft in D&D, I still feel you're now playing a horror campaign as opposed to a fantasy campaign.
What about elves and cyberpunk?
See, again, to me, that's cyberpunk. That's transhumanism more than fantasy, especially since in that particular game, everyone was human first and then goblinized into fantasy races. And while I do like the trick, cute nod that dragons are CEOs, I do like that.
Yeah, I didn't even actually know that. I've despised that game so much. I've never actually knew that everyone was human and then turned into fantasy races.
The process was called goblinization.
See, I would argue urban fantasy is still fantasy, but I can't think of any board games that I'd park under that umbrella anyway. So I'm going to give it to you. I'll let you have it. I'm not going to argue too hard.
The only thing, the big license I can think of that's been in various types of games that fits that would be Dresden Files. And then you've got the White Wolf stuff, right? The mage in particular is not horror the way werewolf or werewolf's not totally horror either. But like compared to vampire, I would say mage and Dresden Files are the one there.
Okay, but I was going specifically board games. And well, there's a Dresden File board game. There's no White Wolf board games that I...
There are multiple. They just none of them were ever got a lot of hype.
I just don't know about them. Never mind then.
They never got a lot of hype. RPG companies don't seem to be all that great at producing popular board games.
Yeah, the one I think of urban fantasy, I suppose it all kind of depends. Like the movie Bright is definitely yes. fantasy. Like that falls into fantasy. There are elves and
fae. There's your Shadowrun.
And it's Shadowrun-y, but it's definitely they are different races. Certainly they are converted humans. That one falls into both urban fantasy and proper fantasy, I think. I say the question that you run into on this topic is whether or not you are thinking of that medieval, and I use that in quotes, sort of vibe, the fake medieval, historical feel to it, fantasy versus modern fantasy. And I think in our case, we're talking generally about the more quote unquote historical fantasy, styles generally.
That's definitely where my mind went. Like, I thought Deanna might be full on urban fantasy. If there's fae and Feywild and magic, then it's fantasy. I wasn't sure if we were all on the same page here.
I feel that way. I just don't think I couldn't think of any board games that fell in there. So I'm like, I'm not going to argue too hard.
Now, I did look up Board Game Geek, since they're considered, you know, the expert repository on board game knowledge. They claimed fantasy games are those that have themes and scenarios that exist in a fictional world. I'm like, okay, that's pretty dang broad. It's a genre that uses magic and or other supernatural forms as a primary element to plot, theme, or setting. That, I think, sticks out. Like, that I thought was pretty interesting. The fact that there has to be supernaturality or magic for it to be fantasy, and I did like that. Fantasy is generally distinguished from science fiction and horror by the expectation it steers clear of scientific or macabre themes. Fair enough. Though these can be a great deal of overlap between the three. Now, it talks about elements found in a fantasy game, and I'm not sure if I agree with this one as much. This seems like it was written by, like, Wargamers or something years ago and never edited. But creatures that are common in fantasy books and comics, such as orcs, trolls, goblins, and dragons, magic that can be used with units or abilities, and can involve a struggle between good and evil. Like, that C one, like there has to be a struggle between good and evil forces for it to be fantasy?
That's a bit of a...
might, but still, it's an odd one to feel the need to...
But I totally agree with that whole, there has to be magic or supernatural forms. Like, I almost wonder if you took, like, here's an example, Battle Lore. The original Battle Lore is just the War of the Roses, or was it the Hundred Year War? It's one of the two. I forget which right now. It's not important to this particular topic, but it's a historical battle and historical units with historical forces on historical maps, and everything's historic, but they themed it all fantasy. Like, it's actually dwarves versus goblins instead of, I think it's the French versus the English. But there was no reason for it to be fantasy. And at that point, I'm like, it's a historic game with special looking minis. But then they added in a rule for magic so that on every die, there's a symbol that has a magic symbol. And you get to put those on a little cup and you can spend them to do special things. And in a historic game, that would probably just be like command points or something, or represent your leaders pushing your units harder. But by throwing that in, I think it really does make Battle Lore a fantasy game, even though it's like a pure historic war game otherwise.
Yeah, I mean, we've been talking about Stratego a lot lately for various reasons, and you can really easily just, you know, put a different figure on your Stratego and call it fantasy. But I don't think it is until you take it and do some of the re-themes that we talked about during our Stratego episode, where they actually took the concept of Stratego and turned it into a Lord of the Rings game.
Yes.
Without just painting over the figures.
Now, fairy tales in general, I'm not even I assume that's fantasy. I don't see how it wouldn't be. Like, to me, that's kind of in between in folklore and mythology. I think all of those fit under fantasy just as well. Like, it doesn't have to be elves and dwarves. It can be Achilles and Trojan horses.
Yeah, I think people are talking in the chat about Norse gods, and I think as much, you know, the Norse fairy tales, for the lack of a better term, are just as much fairy tales as tales of the Fae from the Celtic legends.
Yep. And then the one I'm on the fence about, and normally I'd say sci-fi, is steampunk. And the only reason I'm on the fence is D&D put out an extremely popular setting called Eberron that is very much steampunk, with lightning rails and airships and robot characters. And I think most people still consider it fantasy, but is that just because it's D&D?
I think that's because it's D&D. To me, that's right in there. That's pushing you right into sci-fi, because you have added the science of flight and mechs, and whether it's steam or not, you know, steam or electric, it's still science.
Steampunk, that fits Victorian? The board game geek. Steampunk is just Victorian setting sci-fi in my mind. Yep. Like that's
like to me, it's Victorian cyberpunk. Like that's exactly what it is. But then I guess it's Victorian Shadowrun if you're looking at Eberron, because right. it's still D&D, right? You got your yeah. gnomes and dwarves and you're fighting dragons and doing all the D&D things. You just happen to also have Warforged in this very high tech-ish city. Though it's all driven by magic. So that's I you put in the science, but then you explain the science away as magic. That,
well,
that's,
yeah, but that's
it's any, like they're trying to keep it fantasy.
Any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. So there we go.
Yeah. And the last one I was thinking about was post-apocalyptic. And normally I'd say, no, hell no, definitely not fantasy. But I have seen, especially in the 70s and 80s, many post-apocalyptic movies where the remains of humanity, obviously based on the idea of that generic German, French, English, medieval time period, where you're back to knights, except now they're on motorcycles.
Unless you're going with the fantasy, creatures, fantasy magic, if you're just going a little, bringing it back historically again, but with motorcycles, I don't call that fantasy. Now, I think there have been some out there where they do bring in the magic, magic resurges yep. after the apocalypse, then you're getting into fantasy. But even then, again, it depends on where they're falling on the use of science along with magic. And it can get a little questionable in there.
Right. Because you can have like telepathy and stuff and it's still sci-fi. It's
psionics is an interesting one. Right? Once you threw psionics in Dark Sun, does that make it a sci-fi setting? Technically, Dark Sun is a sci-fi setting. Because not only are there psionics, it's also post-apocalyptic. It's a world that was destroyed by magic, and you're dealing with the after effects.
Yeah, we get into the whole fact of, Star Wars, is it fantasy or is it science fiction or is it both? And really, it's both.
I call it science fantasy, right? Like, I think Star Wars is lacking is nowhere does Star Wars try to explain the science. They never explain what a warp drive is. They never explain anything, which is why I think it's more on the fantasy side, as opposed to, say, Battlestar Galactica, which may have some fantasy elements and maybe even a hero's journey. But they spend an awful lot of time explaining how things work.
Right. Yeah, I think the original concepts of Star Wars were fantasy, 100%.
Yeah,
I think it has drifted with other authors and things since then. But I think when you look at the first movie, it's a fantasy movie. It's 100%.
If you get prequels, it's even more fantasy. There's like midichlorians and virgin births and stuff. It gets even wackier. So
yeah, that's true.
Anyways, back to board games.
Yes. I think I'm good. I think in general, I think this one we kind of all agree on, right? Like you need magic, you need elves and dwarves, and you need no science, I guess, as a hard and fast rule. Once you start throwing science in there, you're getting into steampunk or whatever. So I think we're all on the same page for this one. And I actually wasn't sure before we started this episode. So good to know. So I think at this point, we'll move on to talking about our favorite fantasy board games. And let's see if we mess up and name a game that doesn't fit what we just talked about.
Now, as usual, this list is in no particular order.
All right, I'm going to start with the biggest dungeon crawler we played in the biggest box in the heaviest game, and that is the cooperative game Gloomhaven from Cephalofair Games. We didn't even finish the game. I don't even know how far we are in. I felt like we were like just past halfway, but I don't know. But even with that, I think it's the game I put the most hours into that isn't a role-playing game, because back in the day, we played an awful lot of Warhammer and AD&D and Cyberpunk and 12-hour sessions and stuff. But for board games, I think this is the game I've spent the most of my life playing. It's a fantastically detailed, rather heavy cooperative card management game in a unique fantasy world. And that world is part of why I want to call this one out, because what I like a lot about Gloomhaven is the world you're exploring, because it's not just your usual elves and dwarves and goblins. Now, we haven't tried Frosthaven. I haven't tried Bugs and Buttons. But I will stand by what we said in our Jaws of the Lion review. Even though I'm only putting Gloomhaven on the list, I think the main game is what deserves to be here. If you're going to get into Gloomhaven, start with Jaws of the Lion. That has not changed.
Yeah, Gloomhaven is one of the first ones that popped into my head as well. There's a lot of backstory going on, and you're playing in a very established world that has its own mythos and its own fantasy creatures like vermlings and inox, and And to me, that makes it a really strong fantasy game.
Another thing I just thought of, too, is it kind of takes the heroic tropes that you find in most fantasy games and fantasy settings of you are the good guys and kind of twist that on its end. For anyone who played Gloomhaven, I was kind of shocked by the way the campaign starts. You are not the good guys in Gloomhaven. So going back to Board Game Geek's definition, I guess it's not a fantasy game because it doesn't qualify for number C.
Well, I think one of the interesting things that has appealed to me for Gloomhaven is that they don't rely on the standard fantasy creatures. It's not just orcs and goblins and trolls. They've gone their own direction with that.
All right. My first pick is Terra Mystica. I love this game. I have played it a ton. One of the things I love about Terra Mystica is the asymmetric factions. And those factions are built around fantasy tropes. We got mermaids, giants, halflings, witches, alchemists, dwarves, etc. The game could easily be rethemed. And I mean, they did turn it into a sci-fi version with Gaia Project, but it really shines as it stands.
See, this is one that like you say it, and I'm like, Terra Mystica. No, that's a Civ game. It's like an empire building game. It's engine building. I'm like, oh, I guess those are fantasy races. Like, if that, and you do have that pool of power you're moving. I guess that could be magic. But for some reason, that game just doesn't bring fantasy to my mind at all. But then you got the player boards in front of you with the pictures and the way the giants play different than the halflings. And I'm like, I guess it's fantasy. I do like the game. It's a very solid game. It's one we need to get playing again. Props to Board Game Arena for making it very manageable and quick.
Yeah, no, it's one of those games that's absolutely 100% a fantasy game. But if you're not looking at it, it doesn't necessarily. It's kind of that not painted on theme, but getting there. It's verging on that.
It's tied in, but it could easily be unlaced and retied somewhere else.
Yeah, no, absolutely. So my first game is Clank, a deck building adventure. You're delving down into dungeons, but be careful to make too much noise, and you have that angry dragon to deal with. Good versus evil right there. And your fantasy monsters. Can you escape with a loop? If you're lucky, the local town people might drag your rotting carcass back out of the dungeon. This is a great deck builder, variable market, and some fun randomization, making for a very reasonably quick dungeon adventure for beginner and more advanced dungeoneers. My family only has the base game, and we have yet to bore of it. But even if we did, there are a number of expansions, even without going to the, you know, Clank in Space and other versions that keep it in that fantasy realm and expand the options.
Yeah, that's a great choice. I completely forgot about Clank. It's like the essence of dungeon crawling. What's more typically fantasy than that?
Yeah, big Clank fan. Have been for a while. We have the first expansion, Sunken Treasure. Which added things like flooded chambers and aqua monsters to go with it. I liked it because it added to the game without changing it too much, which to me is exactly what I want from an expansion like this. More cards in the market, more new things to buy. What I really want to do with Clank is try Legacy. Now, I know it's long out of print, hard to find, and I think there's a Legacy 2 coming, but that is something I would love to play through with the three of us. My next one is Tyrants of the Underdark, a Dungeons and Dragons mashup of units on a map and deck building. I adore this game, and I find it sad you don't hear anything about this game anymore. Like, they just did a new printing. I don't remember if it was last year or the year before. It includes the expansion content, which sadly was only ever one extra set of cards, which gave you two new decks to play. But they put this out. It's back on the market. It's at a cheaper price point than the original and comes with the expansions. And no one's talking about this. Now, I am personally bummed that the game didn't explode more. I would have liked to buy multiple different decks. Right now, it's all about the drow, but throw in some other races. I want a Smirf Neblin deck. Come on. Deep gnomes fighting it over in the Underdark. I think that would be fantastic. This game just seemed like it had plenty of room to expand, and I don't know why it didn't take off. The only thing I can think of is the D&D players wanted D&D-style combat with heroes and battling things, not a deck-building army game. And while the army players don't want this weird purple theme with these dark-skinned elves, that's the only thing I can think of.
Yeah, I had this one on my shortlist but I crossed it out because somehow it just didn't like feel fantasy to me. And I don't know why, because it's drow, it's Underdark, it's D&D. And I like the game. I enjoy the gameplay. I can't figure out, like, I was thinking about it critically and I just couldn't figure out why. I was like, no, not that one. I'm glad you ended up putting it in there. But and I do agree with you. I wish they had put out expansions and more content.
Yeah. Hashtag not my dark elves. this game, I can see the appeal. It just didn't hit with me. And I think there were various reasons why it didn't. It's definitely a fantasy game. Just wasn't what didn't end up being for me.
All right. Next up, I have Small World. And I think everyone is probably familiar with this one. It's actually not one of my favorite games of all time, but I think it's a classic. It probably should have been in last week's list. Again, we're looking at a bunch of asymmetrical player factions. And again, we've got all the fantasy tropes. Dwarves, elves, giants, halflings, orcs, trolls, sorcerers. And I feel like the theming is tied in pretty nicely. Like, when you're playing Small World, folks aren't very likely to say, hey, the red dude's over there. They're going to be saying, those are the orcs, move the orcs, you know? So I feel like it's tied in tight enough, you know?
And I do love the whole mashup, right? Like, you've got whatever the bombardier, and you get bombardier halflings and bombardier trolls, and it actually changes up the way you play each race. And then the whole thing where you don't play one race for the entire game, which is also very unique, actually. I can't think of very many other fantasy games where you don't stick with, you know, the same characters from start to finish, or the same faction, at least. I'm a fan. We never actually owned the base game. Back when this game was popular, it was popular enough that enough locals had it that if I ever wanted to play it, I could. I do dig the app, though. That is actually my preferred way to play Small World on a tablet. It's a little small for the phone. If you are looking for that, though, it's weird because it's called Small World 2 due to a licensing hiccup when they first released it.
I fully nominate that app. It is actually what brought me from I don't care for Small World to I like the game.
Yeah, Small World is interesting. It's one of those games where there's probably a lot of people who don't know that Small World 2 is Small World 1. It's just, you know, say, oh, you know, Small World 2 is great. I wonder what the original one was like. Oh, it's the same thing. It's just
The original. It had to do with a different company putting out a game named Small World that wasn't based on the board game. That's all it is.
As usual. So my next one is Draconis Invasion. We haven't talked about this one in a little while, but this is a deck builder with a fixed market in the lineage of Dominion, but with some interesting bits added on. You're fending off invading armies of evil and trying to remain strong in the face of overwhelming hordes. Stand strong, slay the beasts to win, or just run terror if it gets to be too much. Now, this was a Kickstarter we previewed, and frankly was one of the few previews we've done that we actually kind of enjoyed. We didn't have constant complaints about component quality or lacking rule books, another thing. Now, while I admit the Dominion style is not everyone's cup of tea, if you do enjoy deck builders, this game has a notable quantity of cards. It's 500 in the base set to vary up your setups and plays. And there are more on the way soon.
Yeah, it's a solid game. I know it's one of your favorites. I'm looking forward to checking out the expansions. Yeah, I wonder what could be in that box.
So the only thing I think Sean missed there that's pretty important for people who don't know the game, this is cooperative. This is a cooperative Dominion-style deck builder, which alone really makes it stand out versus games like Dominion. My next one is a big one, a big heavy one. That is Dungeon Lords from Czech Games Edition. Now, this game was not what I expected at all. It's one of the biggest examples of wrong expectations. I thought it was going to be a silly, light game, kind of like the video game Dungeon Keeper, you know, the one where you get to abuse your little goblin. And drop people into potions and stuff like that and sacrifice people. It's not that at all. Though the looks match, like the little goblin people kind of look like the goblin from Dungeon Keeper. And I think there was some intention there. The thing is, this is a rather heavy and punishing Euro game about building dungeons, dealing with invading heroes, keeping your monsters fed, keeping your dungeons from collapsing. And that's all things you have to manage at once. It's a little ridiculous. Now, it gets even heavier when you throw in the expansions, but it gets even better. It's just more of the awesomeness. If anyone is interested in checking this game out, look for the Happy Anniversary Edition. It has all of the expansion content as well as some promos and revised boards and things like that. This is a fantastic game. Wasn't at all what I expected, but I love it.
Yeah, this one I haven't tried yet.
Yeah, I love this game. Oh, Sean, you should try it. It has been way too long since we played it. And once you get over that whole mixed expectations hurdle, the game rocks.
Put it this way, I think it's heavier than any game we've introduced you to. So, side note, squirrel. Not really, because I'm still talking Dungeon Lords. So one of the things Dungeon Lords does is it gives you a separate rule book that walks you through a tutorial for the first, say, three turns of the game. And it goes through an invasion of heroes and how best to manage your monsters to defeat these heroes and how to set things up. Well, the rule book literally says, now that you've played this, ask the other players if they still want to play the game. It is likely this game wasn't what they expected. I'm like, it literally in the rule book is like, yeah, you might not have been expecting this amount of brain burn. Check with your players if they're still interested in playing. Exit if now. They are, continue this way. I'm like, wow. At least the rule book set that expectation. Like reading it, I'm like, okay, this is going to be different. But man, when you get it down, the first play will probably be terrible. But once you get it, once you see it happen, once you see how it works and why you might want to, you know, not lure the heroes to your place right away, or why you might want to build something for turn six and turn one just in case, then it becomes fantastic.
All right. Next up, I've got Destinies. And I talked about this before. The settings for Destinies reminds me of this Amiga game that we used to play back in the 90s. It's like it's taking all the fantasy tropes of European Middle Ages, Christian folklore, and saying, OK, all of this is real. Prophecies, end of days, got angels, demons, witches, it's all real. You can go to a church, you can get blessed. You can kill a werewolf by melting down silver and making a weapon. You know, it just runs with that. And then I like the game because of the which way make a story. I like the game because of the which way make a choice story elements. We've only played once, but I really enjoyed it, and I can't wait to get it back to the table.
Now, one of the things that sets this apart from like a witch way that I loved is because the world would change. Like if someone else's character got to the spot first and found the thing, I couldn't then go find it. Right. That's where it kind of beats out other games with that kind of witch way feel and why this is like wholly app driven. Now, the video game Dana was alluding to on the Amiga was called Darklands, which is actually based on the Dark Eye or Dachschwarz Arg, Germany's most popular role playing game. Something that's going to come up a bit in a little bit later.
I felt like the app for Destinies wasn't like a gimmick.
No,
it actually really drove the heart of the game and allows you to have that developing world, which is super cool.
And I'm sure regular viewers already know what that next game that has just been hinted at will be. But up first, I'm not going there. I'm going with the one that started the franchise, the OG Valeria Card Kingdoms. So a tableau builder that's super easy to pick up, but with a huge range of replayability, even before you start picking up the many, many expansions cards that add to the variability. You roll the dice and everyone gets to activate cards. You know, they've done it in space now with Space Base and you know, Valeria is in there with the earlier fantasy theming of that. Activate your card, you know, choose what everyone gets to activate cards. Then you kill or hire. That's it. That's pretty much your whole game. Now, I do complain about the grammar of Duke cards, but as long as everyone agrees on how you read them, it's fine.
Yeah, it's Valeria Card Kingdoms is a great game. Like, I strongly feel like everyone should just try this game once. At some point, period, the end.
I know a few people, though, that don't like this game because of the resource glut. And honestly, the first time we played was at Origins at the Daily Magic booth, their first time ever at Origins, very purple booth with purple nerds. The designer was there and we learned the game from him and he explained his reasoning on why the game works this way and what he wanted out of it. And I probably would have complained about this if I hadn't. So for those that do find it odd, like you just pile up a ton of stuff by the end of the game, that's part of the game. It's supposed to feel like you hoarding wealth and having amassed and built something by the end. Think of yourself as, you know, a dragon on your hoard or the Duke sitting with their treasure room. That is supposed to be part of the game. You're supposed to have a pile of stuff left, which is why the Duke scoring is so important in that game. And why, if you read it wrong, it can really mess up your final score. My next one is Caverna the Cave Farmers from Mayfair Games originally. At least that's where my version comes from. I think Lookout Games is the current publisher. Now, this is one kind of like Terra Mystica that I tend to forget is fantasy. But because a big part of the game is farming, right? It's an Uwe Rosenberg farming game. It's the follow-up to Agricola. right? You're farming and you're building your buildings and you're having kids and you're going and putting out animal pens and you got a dog that lives in your house, right? But the thing is, you're dwarves. That's not enough to make a fantasy meet. But a big mechanism in this game is you can send your dwarves down into the caves and they go on quests and you roll random rolls to see how far they get and they can bring up resources and they can battle things down there and level up and get better at delving next time. Now, I got to admit, this is pretty much on the top of the need to get it to the table again list, though actually our conversation a few minutes ago about Dungeon Lords might have put it ahead. The two of those are pretty up there on the, man, Sean hasn't gotten to try these. We need to play them with Sean as well as other people. To me, this is Uwe's best game. The only problem was I bought a box insert for it.
You are doomed to never play it again.
The real reason why Sean has never played Caverna.
Yep. That's the box insert curse. Is that Bellhop's Law number 4? If you build a box insert for a game, I can't say it'll never hit the table again, but it'll hit the table less often, even though that's not the point of a box insert.
If you build it, you won't play.
Yes, if you build it, you won't play.
Next up, I have Aventuria, which is a game we were hinting at that is based on The Dark Eye. It's a great fantasy setting. It's a little dark and grim at times and definitely not family friendly. It gives off Warhammer fantasy vibes. I love this game so much. I enjoy the mechanic where you need to decide which cards to turn into resources. And that's a choice that's become pretty popular right now. We're seeing it in CCGs like Star Wars Unlimited and Altered. But Aventuria was the first time I encountered the concept and I really dig it.
Was that in Altered? I know it was in Lorcana. I don't remember it being in Altered.
We only played Altered the one time, and yeah. I thought it also had something it similar. Might. And I thought they were like, this is our brand new thing that no one has ever done. And we were like, mm-hmm. And then we sat down for the other demo for Star Wars, and they were like, this is the brand new thing that no one else has ever done. And we were like, mm-hmm.
Yeah, this is the game, obviously, I alluded to earlier. This is the Dark Eye card game translated to English, and we love it. Game is still supported. For some reason, hard to find in stores. I don't know why it's available. If anyone can't find it, just I'll send you a link. It's not hard to find like it was, but it still just doesn't show up on some of the usual channels. What looks awesome is they have improved the game recently within the last year where they've changed the campaign rules for character advancement and made it a little better than just I get to tick up one of my skills by one. And the newest adventures they're releasing for it finally have more of a branching path. Like if you fail here, go this way. If you succeed here, go this way. And the results of your skill checks don't just, you know, modify the start of the next battle. I am really looking forward to diving back into Aventuria. It's something we need to start doing again. Just need these eyes to get finally fixed up again.
You know, 80, I have an appointment on Friday. They're 80 some percent there. I so want to play the new stuff they've put out in the last year.
Yeah, unfortunately, the only reason we stopped playing this was, you know, visual acuity issues. Otherwise, we would have kept playing this all the way through. 100%.
Probably.
All right, well, my next one is One Deck Dungeon. Now, I actually came to this game via the app before the board game. It's a roguelike dungeon crawler where the deck itself builds out the dungeon, but then becomes the loot with each victory. It's a simple enough dice placement system that makes it really easy to set up and then play again and again and again and again. And it has a fun leveling up system that means the more you play, the better your characters can get. This roguelike is actually more roguelike than many things that claim that title.
I've actually never tried this one.
So going back to the CG realm, so quite a while ago, they're still around, sorry, at their old location. I played a single deck based dungeon crawler, but I don't remember if it was this. It might have been 5-Minute Dungeon, which is another one I think was out at the time. And the problem I had with it is that it was single player only. I would always rather play with a group, and again, I'll play video games before I play a solo game. Is this solo or is this
One Deck Dungeon is one or two solo or two
one player. Or two?
Yeah. And also interestingly, they just dropped a new game on Board Game Arena, Mini Rogue, and I played a round of it, and I'm like, oh, this really wants to be One Deck Dungeon, but I'd rather be playing One Deck Dungeon. So
fair enough. My next one is another Dungeons and Dragons game, and that is Lords of Waterdeep. I, for one, dig the theme here. I know some people don't as much or feel it's superfluous. I don't know. I like the little D&D tie-ins, even though they are tenuous. I at least recognize names of places and people, and I still call them warriors and mages, even though they might just be red and blue cubes. More importantly, though, I love the gameplay in this game. I love the engine building. It's the same thing I liked in Danger. I like worker placement games where you add more worker placement spots, and those worker placement spots are directly chosen by the players. That is just something I like in games, I've learned. I love the way you start off this game and there's, you know, four or five choices. They're not that big, and a couple are just get resources. But as the game goes on and people build more buildings, there's more options. I also love the stab you in the back mechanics from the Scoundrels of Skullport, part of the one expansion that was released. Like, this is a game I'm kind of shocked stopped there. I was really hoping for some more content for Lords of Waterdeep. And yeah, this is an older game, but if someone came up to me and said, hey, you want to play Lords of Waterdeep? I'm like, hell yeah, let's go.
Yeah, particularly once you mix in the expansion, I really dig this game. It has been a long time since we played it. I'll bring it out to the next public play event.
Yeah, I'm one who thinks it's very pasted on theme. It wasn't a bad game. It just had nothing to do with D&D as far as I was concerned.
All right. My next one is Fighting Fantasy Adventures, the board game from Martin Wallace based on the classic Fighting Fantasy game books from Steve Jackson and Ian Livingston. I loved Which Way game books like this when I was a kid, and I was very excited to see this back in board game form. We had the chance to check out a prototype version a while back, and I really enjoyed it. You lay cards out to form a dungeon map and make which way to go choices, which reveal more map pieces, loot to collect, and monsters to fight. The game features many fantasy RPG tropes, and I think it's going to appeal to anyone who's nostalgic about the old books. If you haven't played the old books, it might fall flat. I don't know. I know for me, there was a nostalgia thing there, and I really enjoyed it.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to seeing the final version of this game. From what I hear, quite a bit has changed a lot from what we saw, to the point that like the publisher was like, okay, stop sharing pictures because they no longer apply anymore. So I don't know. It'll be interesting what it was. The big thing here that I think is going to be a big deciding factor is this, just like the books, technically has permadeath. You can go the wrong way and just boom, you fell in a pit and you're dead. And for fans of the books, they're like, yes, exactly. And then I flip back to the last spot, right? That's now in a board game format. And I don't know if people are going to take it as well in this format.
Yeah, it was fun, but I don't have the nostalgia for the IP. And so I think that did definitely temper it some. That being said, I think a lot of the real fantasy dungeon crawling people are probably going to like this anyway, even if you don't have the memory of the original content, because it really just is a good dungeon crawl. So my next one is Sanctums, called by some Diablo the board game. As a longtime Diablo fan, I don't know if I fully agree that it's Diablo the board game. Still, there is a lot of that styling to it, even if the feel isn't quite right. As a Euro, it does feel a bit sometimes much too much like multiplayer solitaire. You're engaged in more of a race than a battle with each other, for certain. But if you're all right with that limitation, this is a good solid dungeon crawl loot haul game with a big baddie at the end. Now, as a bonus, there are some nice minis if you're looking for some characters to paint.
Yeah, that one's interesting. I don't know. It's so odd. Like they did the tons of loot part of Diablo and the hordes of monsters, but it just doesn't feel like you're slaying anything. And then the end game is just so different from the rest of the game. It feels like you're playing a totally separate game. I don't know. I liked it. But even once I knew what it was, I just like, there's only four characters. They have the same skills every game. You're probably going to level them up in pretty close to the same order because the order just makes sense. And while there's a ton of monsters to fight, they're all just the same graphics with different color gems, red, green, and blue versions of the same. And then when you kill them, you get all these different pieces of gear. Each has its own unique art, which is really impressive. But it's like, it's a sword that does plus one. It's a sword that does minus one. It's a sword that does plus or minus one. It's a sword that does plus one and gives you a, like, it just, there wasn't enough variety. Now, I will say I do like the mechanics in this. It's very much that king me roll for it mechanic of rolling dice and placing them on the cards to do things. And this is the best game I played that uses that mechanic. I love that dice system, but I don't know if it fits in a Diablo game. So that's 5 from each of us. So 15 fantasy game recommendations total. should be more than enough to start a shopping list for someone who's looking to pick up some fantasy games.
Before we stop in the lobby to see what the cardboard connoisseurs have to add, we do have some honorable mentions. Three games you'll have a very hard time finding, and one that's not available yet. But first, I need to nominate Zensu. No? Okay, how about Xylitar, which has the craziest fantasy background story I've ever heard of? No. The actual one I'm here to talk about is Shadows Over Camelot from Days of Wonder. One of the first cooperative board games and one of the first to introduce the concept of a hidden traitor. This Arthurian game continues to be a favorite of ours with its mix of clever card play and light RPG elements.
All right, well, I've got Tales of Arabian Nights. This adventure game from Zedman is pretty much legendary at this point, a game that's way more about the experience than trying to win. Wander around and experience the world of Arabia as told by Scheherazade. Interestingly, this one is coming back and tied to our last honorable mention. WizKids this year is releasing Tales of the Arthurian Knights, something we're hoping to get a peek at Origins.
Yeah, I'm so on the fence about that. Tales of the Arabian Knights is just so fantasyful, and I just don't see Arthurian being able to be that out there, I guess, is the best way I can think of to word this. We'll see. Maybe they've done a fantastic job.
I'm sorry. That's another one that's on the Sean Must Play list. You're not well enough read in the Arthurian legends if you don't think they can be out there. That's all.
Oh, I guess.
Yeah, I'm kind of with D on that one.
Like the story of the 1001 Arabian Nights, there's an awful lot of messed up stuff in there.
Oh, there's some pretty messed up stuff in the Arthurian legends too.
I'll tell you. Talking about eight ancient legends, I'm pretty sure Hyperborea fits there as well. Though this one you can still find, despite being out of print. And I think that's due to the Dungeon Lords problem. The box cover here looks like a super dungeon crawler that even gives kind of a gauntlet feel, because you've got like a fighter, a mage, an archer, and like one's red, green, and blue, and they're color coded. And it looks like this huge, I'm going to go in a dungeon, kill monsters. But that's not this game at all. This is it kind of looks like an adventure game like Talisman 2, but it's not. It's an area control hex based euro that uses bag building really well, where you pull cubes out of your bag based on how leveled up your character is, and then place those cubes on your board to take actions like moving your armies and exploring ruins. I really like Hyperborea. If you can find the expansion, it's even better. All we've been able to do is play with a print and play version of the expansion because it's so hard to find. I'd still dig Hyperborea. I think it's really good. If you like area control, folk on a map games with a fantasy theme, shop around, because you can still find Hyperborea sometimes dirt cheap because new old stock. People are looking to get rid of it.
Our last honorable mention is also from Asmodee and Equinox, and that's soon to be released collectible card game Altered. I haven't had this. All right. I haven't been this hyped for a collectible game in a long time. We demoed it at Gamma Expo and it had us hooked. This is a two-player card game that's very different from your usual dueling game, featuring classic fairy tale and folklore characters and their companions who are working to meet up at the end of their journey.
All right, well, that's it for our fantasy game recommendations. But while we were sharing our favorite fantasy games, the lobby has been busy shouting out some of theirs. So these include Roger says just Fractured Sky was really fun.
That one I don't know offhand.
No, I don't know that one.
Roger is asking, would Blood Rage be considered fantasy? And I think so, absolutely.
Yeah,
definitely. And a lot of the lists I saw online included that one as well. Eggman Jr. is asking about Townfolk Tussle.
Again, I don't think you have the fantasy, do you? Like, is there magic? Again, that's your question.
Yeah, I think that one comes off as fantasy looking. It's got the look, but nothing else really to make it fantasy. I've been saying the Reckoners would be urban fantasy. And
there you go. There's an urban fantasy game for you to check out, D.
There you go.
And Tex asking, would Quad Heroes be a fantasy game?
I don't know what else I'd qualify it as. It's almost like a cartoon game. Like cartoon fantasy, like it's almost like a different. Yeah, that one's rough. Yes, because I don't know where else I put it. It's not sci-fi. It's not horror. It's not urban fantasy. It's not historic. It's not modern. Yeah, I guess it would.
There we go. Ryan's got a few here for us. Descent Journeys in the Dark, first edition.
Yep.
Defenders of the Realm.
That one's, yeah.
You're telling Dragon Dungeon Lords, we already covered, and Valeria Card Kingdoms we have covered as well, with Roger throwing in Dungeon Pets.
See, I have not tried that. Everyone tells me it's a simpler version of Dungeon Lords, and I love Dungeon Lords. So I'm kind of like, why would I play Dungeon Pets if I can play Dungeon Lords? Sure. But I should try it sometime. Maybe it'll be like scratch the itch thing. Excuse me.
Eggman Jr. throws in an Oathsworn is my favorite fantasy campaign boss battler, with a story campaign that precedes each battle.
Okay, Townsfolk Tussle, you can find an old jalopy. There's a car in it. It's not fantasy.
Fair. There we go.
Unless the car has feathered wings and fairies riding in the back.
No, it's an obstacle. I don't know. The game looks interesting. I hadn't really looked into it before. Oathsworn does look good. Thinking of Oathsworn, it makes me wonder it's not, because there's machines, but I'd be hard pressed not to call Horizon Zero Dawn fantasy.
Yeah,
that one. Well, again, that's sort of a future past mix thing that gets into the whole Star Wars.
For sure,
you know,
science fiction.
Yeah, it's the science fantasy.
The Lords of Waterdeep meeples are indeed an awesome upgrade, and yes, I think they really fix the whole abstract cube problem, but Sean argues otherwise.
See, I don't know, it still feels like D&D to me, because D&D is not just about combat, it's the backstabbing, and you're trying to work for the lord of the city, and you're playing intrigue cards on other people, and you're manipulating heroes to go out and complete quests for you.
And I love the quest cards. I love the quest cards in that game. So,
Tame owlbears. Come on, you send a bunch of heroes, stupid heroes, to go tame an owlbear for you.
Eggman points out that Sanctum could use an expansion that provides an alternate end game.
Yeah. It's two separate games.
Yeah, I get where everyone's coming from on that. Absolutely.
I would buy that. I agree.
And Ryan throws in Mice and Mystics.
We debated that one on our list. We did talk about that quite a bit. I need to play it again. I need to break it out. Heck, the kids. No, I don't think our kids are too old. They love that kind of fantasy. It definitely fits. It definitely qualifies. So I'm not. The reason we didn't put it on is we never finished. We played it with our kids when they were too young, but I think we only got three scenarios in. So I don't want to recommend a game that might have a terrible ending, or like there might be something where the whole thing falls off a cliff eventually. And I don't know, because we haven't played that far.
We were talking it out. We went back and checked and realized we hadn't played it since 2016. And that was Mo's argument for not including it. And I was like, all right.
All right. And then not using the hashtag, but still thrown in there, Orion has brought up Hellbringer, where the pledge manager will be closing at the end of the month. And Charlie Brown mentioned...
I've been looking for an update, and one just came out like yesterday or today. I was like, oh, good. Good to see that's still going.
And Charlie Brown mentions Too Many Bones, which I think falls cleanly into it. So thanks, everyone, for coming out, and thanks for using hashtag ask in our recommendation. I think this worked out really nicely. I think we're going to be using this more going forward.
So you all know how much our family's been enjoying the Holiday Hijinks series of games from our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild. Well, there's a new game in the series, and we haven't even gotten to try it ourselves yet.
Your careers as wedding planners are on the line. Find out what went wrong and fast.
The Marriage Mix-Up, title number 9 in the Holiday Hijinks line, is an escape room style game in just 18 cards. As a group, you will solve a series of puzzles to unravel a mystery.
Now, this is the first entry in the Holiday Hijinks series that actually requires two players, because marriage comes from two perspectives.
The Marriage Mix-Up will be available at Origins Game Fair at booth 1233. Be sure to tell them the Tabletop Bellhop sent you.
Or you can head over to the Grand Gamers Guild website, where you can grab it as a standalone game or part of a discounted bundle.
And remember, anytime you're going to Grand Gamers Guild, you can use our code BELLHOP to save 10%.
Origins Game Fair is coming up quick. So quick that our next episode will be the last one we record before the con. The Wednesday after that, we won't be recording, because that's June 19th, the first official day of the convention.
So all three of us will be attending again this year, and we are hyped. We're looking forward to meeting up with friends and fellow podcasters, publishers we've worked with in the past, and meeting up with and making new connections.
Our schedule is starting to fill up, so if you want to set up a meeting with us to discuss business or for fun stuff, reach out to Mo at tabletopbellhop.com.
Now, a couple of quick announcements for the locals.
All right. Our next Brews and Board Game event at Walkerville is scheduled for Thursday, June 27th. If there's a game you want to see on the menu for that night, let me know ahead of time and we'll see what we can do to include it.
I hope to see all you local people out there.
On next, we want to invite everyone to The Summoning, a new entertainment convention launching this year in Windsor. This first event is scheduled for July 20th, 2024, and will be located in the St. Clair College main building.
So there, we are hosting their board game area, which will include a number of free-to-play games, pretty much similar to our Walkerville Brewery events, including menus, so you can know what you might want to check out. Now, the important part, the cool part, is in addition to this, we're planning on offering a set of play-to-win games. That's right, win games. Each game you play from this series of games, you get entered into a draw to take that game home at the end of the event.
Our board game area is only going to be a small part of the event. The Summoning features over $10,000 in trading card game and esports tournament prizes. There's also going to be a cornhole tournament, vendors, a rock wall for climbing, an artist alley, scavenger hunts, and more.
Find more info and purchase advanced tickets at the website we're going to drop in the chat and in our show notes as well. All right, well, now it's time for the Bellhop's Tabletop, where we talk about the games that we've been playing lately.
So we got a big one off the pile of shame and obligation since the last time we were here. So we've got quite a few, but this one was big to me, and that is Mare Nostrum Empires from Academy Games. This is a not quite historic game, debatably fantasy, about ancient empires in the Mediterranean area. Not quite historic because it includes heroes and gods and civilizations that aren't actually contemporary to each other.
Yeah, I will argue loudly with anyone who tries to tell me that Circe is a historical character. Okay, they had Castor and Pollux. I mean, come on. I was amused because we sat down to play it with Gwen, and she's taking an ancient civs history class this semester, and she was like, wait, this is wrong. King Hammurabi did not live at the same time as Julius Caesar. I don't understand this game. And so that was amusing to me. It's fantasy. No, I quite dig it, but I wouldn't call it historic.
Yeah, no, definitely fantasy.
Yeah, we actually talked a bit on whether this belonged on the list or not tonight. And honestly, we only did five each. If we had done like six or seven, I probably would have thrown Mare Nostrum on the list. So for those that don't know it, this is a, to me, fascinating 4X game with some really smooth mechanics. Now, like many of these scary big 4X games with very technical looking manuals with section 3.42, the actual game isn't as bad as it seems. It's one of those games that scares you and scared me. And there's a reason it was on the pile of obligation so long. It's not that hard to learn. And the game plays extremely well at the table. Now, of course, there is that learning curve to get over, but you pick it up pretty quickly. Now, the big thing this game is about is resources that come in 13 different types, except everything is split up. You only have three territories at the beginning of the game, and maybe you can produce two or three of these. And everything you do in the game, you either pay for in gold, which is also very hard to get, or you play in a mix of different resources. So if something costs three, you play three gold, or you pay three different resources. They can't be the same, no duplication. So it's interesting because to be able to get the different sets you need to do more things, you're going to have to trade, expand, and exploit.
And like the game is, I can't say simple, but it's almost simple. It is so close. Yeah. It's just elegant. It flows really smoothly. And the way you trade resources in the game is kind of neat. Like, you have to trade. It is not optional. The person mm-hmm. currently leading on the track gets to pick how many resources are going to be traded. And you lay out all the chosen resources face down in front of you. And then you flip them over and take turns basically drafting off of each other. Like, the leader goes first and picks an item. And then whoever they choose to take one from, that person takes an item and then, you know, it just goes on and on from there. So I liked that mechanic. It works really well. And it removes the negotiation. There's no negotiating. No. There's no, to an extent, there isn't that negotiating to trade. It's not Settlers of Catan trading, you know? So I don't know. I dug that mechanic.
Yeah. And then after everyone's done all their trading, their resources are hidden from everyone. You then get to build things. And this includes building cities, markets, caravans, military units, and so on. Then once everyone's built things, you then go to war, basically. Everyone can move their units, expand their territories, and fight battles. Battles use custom D6 dice, and I'm not going to get into the details here. Now, the other really fascinating part about this game is there are four ways to win. The first is a cultural victory by building the biggest wonder of the world, the pyramids. To build this, you need 12 different resources. There's only 13 in the game, so you have to have 12 different resources or 12 gold, which, trust me, gold's not easy to get either. The next one is part of the game is you can hire heroes. You can hire them. They give you a special ability or build other wonders of the world. If you purchase a mix of 5 of these, you win the game that way. You can also win by occupying territory, but you have to hold 4 legendary or capital cities. And there are only 2 legendary cities on the entire map, so you're going to have to get in someone else's face to be able to do this. Finally, there are 3 tracks in this game that are constantly adjusted. There's a trade leader whose your level in it's based on your markets and your caravans. There's the cultural leader, which is based on how many cities you control, and the military leader based on how many units you have on the board at the end of the turn. Well, if you can be at the top of all 3 of those, you win the game. Your culture has become an empire and has united everyone.
One of the things I really liked about the game is how easy it was to go back and check if you're in the right spot on that track, quickly counting them up because of how clear the iconography on it was and the way they tied together, like all of one thing is triangle, all of one thing, yeah. It was just very easy to double check everyone's count every turn. I really like that. And I like the way it was tracked on there. I love ancient civs as a theme. And I love games where there is no one true way to win. So I think you can easily guess what I thought of this one.
Now, what was interesting is we broke this out with the kids, and our kids have not, despite us owning a lot of games, tried any 4X games. Nothing this big and epic, right? And honestly, the game's not quite as big as epic as you'd expect. It's even shorter than most of 4Xs I've played. But still, compared to what they had played in the past, simple worker placement games or engine builders, there's a lot going on in this game, and it went over really well. Well, I gotta admit, everyone's a little lost at first. Like, they just more were like, I don't know what to do with all this information, deer in a headlights kind of look at the beginning of the game. But after a round or two, I would say probably by the third turn, everyone got it. Like, everyone understood it. And the more we played, the quicker each round went, which is often odd for a game that you get longer at the end. I liked a lot about this game. I love the resource economy. The whole you have to trade in unique goods. And part I hadn't mentioned, it's very important, is you don't get to carry over goods from one turn to another. If you don't spend them, they're gone. So you need to earn all those pyramid things in one turn. Otherwise, you can't build them. I also liked how the leader in each track had an advantage and how that influenced the game. Like Deanna mentioned, how the trade leader gets to decide how much you're trading and gets to go first. Well, the culture leader decides who builds first, and the army leader, the war leader, gets to decide who's going to move their armies first, which in case could be them because they want to invade somewhere before someone else gets to go, or it could be they want to go last to see what everyone else does and sweep in, right? I really like that. And then the way there's 4 ways to win, like there's 4 completely different victory conditions here that are achieved in very different ways. And I think everyone playing when we played was kind of close on 2. And to be fair, when I played, I didn't even realize I won. I was busy trying to do something else and stop Gwen from winning by getting her last wonder. And I counted my resource and went, holy cow, I have 12. I can build the pyramids. I win. So it was even a surprise to me that I managed to, without trying, trade just the right stuff to have enough different resources.
Yeah, I was the military leader for a large chunk of the game. And I have to say, it was more fun. I don't want to say, oh, I'm going to go first. It was much more fun to pick between you and Gwen and go, oh, let's see who Mo's going to attack. Let's make him go first, and then we can all react to it. I don't know. I really enjoyed that mechanic. There's a lot about this game I like. I can't wait to get it to the table again.
Next, we've got Robot Quest Arena. It's another one off the pile of shame and obligation. This one's from Wise Wizard Games. We played a few rounds of this robot battling deck builder with 3 players at a local coffee shop, and I really liked it. Now, what I expected from this was Robo Rally with deck building. And the level of complexity and thinking and planning and strategy and tactics of that. No, this is a fast and furious first person shooter or Super Smash Brothers kind of feeling game, more of a cartoon beat 'em up than anything else. And it's super quick. It was a very quick battle game, and I liked that. And while the components, these are amiibo level, or, you know, Skyrim, what do you call the Skyrim people, or Disney Infinity? Those are the quality of the components in this game.
Yeah, they're probably the single cutest character markers that we have in our entire gaming collection. The game is fast. It's just nice and quick. It's simple. It's enjoyable. For me, if it were any longer, it would overstay its welcome. But because it's so quick, you just shoot through it, and you can shoot through one or two games and move on.
Yeah, and it was definitely quick enough where you wanted to play it a couple more times, or at least one more time, because it was fun and it left you wanting more. It wasn't that, okay, I've done what it is, we can move on to something else now. It's like, oh no, that was fun, let's try again. Yep. Definitely a great game and a solid deck builder. We only just barely in three games saw all the cards available in the deck, and there's quite a range of things that can really swing things depending on what cards are up and what you can buy.
Yeah, I'm really looking forward to letting the kids try this one out. I think they're going to love it, especially Genevieve. I'm also hoping we get to check out some of the expansions at Origins, because based on the research we're doing, it was like every new robot you buy, which comes with another awesome like amiibo like thing, not only adds a character, but a new set of rules. Like one new mechanic is introduced with each of the bots, which just, of course, is giving me the Pokemon thing, and I want to collect them all.
Yeah, I'm super curious about the new rule sets. I'm also super curious to see what the kids think of this one. I think they're going to love it because it's got that super cute Pokemon vibe and robots, sort of programmed movement, King of the Hill-like aspects. It's all stuff they like, so it should be a win.
Yeah, absolutely. The only thing I think it was missing for us is more towards the program movement, but that would have also stretched the game out and made it slower. So I can see why they didn't go there.
Yeah, I admit that's what I wanted from the game. That's what I was expecting, but I'm glad it wasn't there. It's kind of like the Goblin game, Kiss the Goblin, where I'm like, this feels like it needs more. And I'm like, no. Once I sat down and played it, I'm like, no, keep it simple, keep it quick. Let me run in and blow you up in one turn, and then have another player spawn and blow me up, and then have a third player come in and then I respawn, and it's just quick and rapid fire, and there's no, wait, if I go forward two and then turn left and then the pusher pushes me one, I don't want that out of this game.
Yeah, I want to mention that, the no player elimination aspect, that was stellar.
Next up, we tried Oros with four players. It was a rough start. This game has a lot more going on than it seems like at first glance. I think everyone enjoyed it. This is one of the games where I read the rule book and I watched how to play. Sean did as well. And it just doesn't quite get across how the game feels at all. This is a game you have to play once for it to make any sense. And I have a feeling this is going to be the one where the second play is going to really solidify our feelings.
Yeah, this is very much a play it once to learn it game. It's not difficult per se. It's just got some interesting timing rules. And the way the pieces slide and move, there's a learning curve.
Yeah, no, absolutely. This one, I went first, thanks to Schwazi, and made some poor decisions based on because again, we didn't know. None of us knew what the heck was going on. I made some choices, and it turned out they were the wrong choices, and those did, in fact, plague me throughout the rest of the game. But they are choices that I think, looking back, knowing how the game plays now, I would not have made. So I don't think it's one of those, games where normally you're going to break yourself first thing in the game. It's just literally it's because of that first play problem.
Now, for anyone who doesn't know Oros, this is kind of like, to me, it really reminds me of the classic PC game Populous, which honestly is one of my favorite computer games of all time, but Populous in board game form, because you're playing a demigod and you're trying to increase your knowledge, get victory points, which you get by having your cultist build temples on the top of mountains. And while the first step being that you have to make those mountains by using your powers to manipulate land tiles on a globe. It's a square, like it's a flat board, but it represents a globe with things, going off one edge, coming off the other. You're going to use, it's a worker placement game where you're going to take actions to shift tiles, move tiles, mash them together, place and erupt volcanoes, move your followers around, and eventually get them to build temples and sending your followers to study at those temples. Now, studying and building temples gives you wisdom that lets you level up these different abilities.
Visually, I found this game delightful. Like, I love the art style. I love the way the temple pieces stack on top of each other and build up layers. It's colorful. It's got populist vibes. I just really like the way it looks. Component wise, it's also like a physically gorgeous game, but we have the older deluxe version before the game was picked up by Lucky Duck. So I don't know how much I want to go into component quality. Like, we have lovely wooden pieces. Everything's silk screened. There's dual layer boards. It's just really darn pretty. But again, I haven't done the research to see what the current version looks like, so I don't want to give anyone the wrong expectations.
Yeah, from what I've seen, checking out some Board Game Geek pictures, even the cardboard versions, the non-deluxe versions, are still quite nice. Again, we have our pieces are thicker. You know, you get a little bit more height on things, but overall, it's not that much of a difference. So it's not something where you're going to feel horribly left out if you don't have the deluxe pieces. It really is just a fun, visually pretty game, though.
Like, I would guess they would just take the wooden pieces and turn them into cardboard. And even given that, I just love the art and the look of it. So even if it was all cardboard, it's still gorgeous.
Yeah, I enjoyed it. It was heavier than I thought. Like, this is a problem not of complexity as much as number of options. There are so many possible decision points in this game. And when you first start, as Sean pointed out, it's really hard to know what you should be doing. And I think this definitely got better the deeper we dove into the game. I was no longer sliding cut stuff because I don't know what, so it's the action available to slide. I guess I slide it here.
Yeah, this is a game that's going to be so much more fun to play a second time or a third time or a fourth time.
Yeah, and the leveling up of powers, like once you get that wisdom, where you put it, we didn't really grasp as fully what all the different, you know, what differences it was going to make, where it made sense to put that wisdom, because you've got a lot of options. There are 8 different wisdom tracks you can go up on, with different, different results all across. And I think, you know, knowing what we know now, we would have made very different decisions spending some of the early wisdom we had.
Yeah. Well, I think we all did it's a worker placement game, and there's an action that gets me more workers. We must do that, because that's kind of a trope and a rule in most worker placement games. And I don't think that is necessarily the best option in this game, especially early on. So at this point, we tried one game, the smallest map, the most basic layout. And next game, I'm looking forward to doing the exact same thing. I just want to play with that same simple, basic intro game, just to see how much better it plays with what we know now. And then we can dive into the other side of the board and the harder map layouts and all that other fun stuff.
Yeah, because the more guys you unlock, the more, unless they're out on the board and you have to do things to unlock me able to put guys out on the board, you're blocking up more and more of your spaces on your player board and removing worker options instead of giving yourself more. So it's sort of a backwards thing compared to the way most of the worker mechanics that we're used to. So that was neat. Yeah, I'm really eager to explore everything this game has to offer. There are a lot of different possible board setups. And I think that can make some really different gameplay.
Yeah, this is the first worker placement game I can think of playing where you have been punished for unlocking workers at certain points. Mm-hmm. If you weren't fully prepared to use them, you kind of got lost out because of it.
Yeah, one of the first rules we had to look up was, what if I filled all my worker placement spots? All right, up next. Multiple plays, I will say, of Tir na n'og. We played a 5-player game, which was great. It worked really well with 5 players. I didn't seem to add a lot to the game length. Deanna and I talked about this one before, and we're doing a full review at the end of the show. It'll be our last review at the end of the night. So I don't have much more to say about this one right now. But this was your first experience with Tir na n'og. Do you have anything you want to say now before we get to the review later?
I it was fun. I think the theme, I think we've talked about in the past, theme is a little maybe paste it on, but listening for our full review at the end of the show for more.
And then our final gameplay since we were last here was a 4-player game of Cytosis, a cell biology board game from Genius Games. Similar to Tir na n'og, Dee and I talked about this one quite a bit last episode, so it was Sean's first play. Any thoughts on Cytosis, which is going to take a couple more plays before we review it?
There was more to this game than I expected. I was expecting something lighter than it was. And I don't think I had the brain power to fully appreciate it at the time I was taught the board game. It was, you know, end of the night. All right, let's play one more game and let's teach Sean a game that's got some decision points and some complexity to it. And Sean's brain wasn't 100% there for that. So I was pleasantly surprised though, because it's an educationally game. It's got a teacher's insert in it, but no, it's a game. It's real.
Yeah, I think the thing you need to know going into this one is the fact that it's an educational game doesn't make it a little kid's game. It's not super simplistic.
Yeah, I'd almost say this is like high school level science, right? Not grade school level science.
They take it in grade 8 in the Ontario curriculum. So, I mean, it's middle school.
Okay. Yeah, I'm digging it. I think it's a very solid game, especially for an educational game. And it sucks I have to say that, but it's kind of true. I've enjoyed every play. Like for a cell biology game, this game is fantastic. I just can't see calling everyone up and going, hey, next Saturday, you want to get together and play Cytosis and order a pizza? That'll never happen.
Yeah, exactly what you just said.
You know what, though? I can see if we didn't have the wide range of board games available to us. You know, if you had a small board game collection and you were delving into some heavier stuff, I could see doing that with Cytosis. Yeah. No, given the vast, you know, 1,000 games at hand, it's not going to be the choice. But if you're starting off, Cytosis could be a really good choice for a heavier game to get into.
This is going to sound weird, but like I would rather play Cytosis than Robot Quest Arena.
Next step games for Titan, Cytosis, the cell biology board game. I could see it. Like it's got all the mechanics. It's a solid Euro game. There's a multi-step process that can go different ways, and there's resource gathering and there's set collection. Like it's solid. We'll be sharing more once we do the full review. But at this point, I can't see it becoming like, unless we find a fatal flaw with the game, which I can't see, it's going to be a positive review. Now, the only other thing is Deanna and I spent more time with Tir na n'Og, but again, we're going to review that later. So we'll talk about that part of the game later. So that's about all we've been up to lately. What about you? What games hit your table this past week? We'd love to hear about it in the comments. Tag us on social media where you can find everywhere as Tabletop Bellhop, one word. Fire me off an email. Just reach out. I want to know what you're playing.
The One Ring from Free League Publishing, considered by many to be the best role-playing game based on the works of J.R.R. Tolkien. Welcome to our look at the core rulebook.
So the full name of the game is The One Ring Roleplaying in the World of the Lord of the Rings. It's technically the second iteration of the One Ring Roleplaying game, and is currently being published and supported by Free League Publishing, who we do have to thank for providing us with a review copy.
The lead writer on The One Ring is Francesco Nepitello, with further game design by Marco Maggi and rules development by Michelle Garbuggio. It features additional writing by James Michael Spahn, a.k.a. Obi-Spahn Kenobi, and Jason Durrell.
Physically, The One Ring is a hardcover 237-page tome, not counting the index and player resources in the back. The book features a mix of full-color artwork and line drawings on the inside and text that swaps between red and black. It uses a two-column layout, which is easy to read, and multiple callouts, tables, and example boxes. It also has a nice classy touch of a red silk bookmark band.
Now, the setting for this Middle-Earth RPG is the Third Age in the Eriador region of Middle-Earth. 24 years after the Battle of the Five Armies and the events in The Hobbit, and over 50 years before the events in the Lord of the Rings trilogy that most people are familiar with.
While we're talking about the core rulebook for The One Ring here, we do suggest that people who are interested in this game and setting check out The One Ring Starter Set, which we reviewed back in May of 2022 on episode 171 of our podcast, MIA, Dealing with Absent Players.
The starter box really is the best entry point for this Tolkien-based RPG, featuring simplified rules, pre-generated characters, information on the Shire, and a hobbit-based adventure to go with it. It also comes with a set of custom dice that most people are going to want if they plan on playing The One Ring.
So speaking of dice, let's get into the mechanics of The One Ring system.
Okay, first, I want to note this is going to be a super high-level overview and not a chapter-by-chapter look at the core rulebook. Yeah. We just want to give you a feel for what the game is about, how it works, and then leave most of the discovery to you.
Now, the One Ring uses a simple dice pool mechanic. Roll one feat die plus a number of success dice equal to the appropriate ability rating. Compare the result to the target number for that ability. If you meet or beat the target number, you succeed. In addition, any sixes rolled on success dice provide special successes. These can be spent to activate character abilities, do combat maneuvers, or just indicate extraordinary successes.
And one of the key highlights in this game is that feat die. This thing's very interesting because it's a D12, but it only has the numbers 1 to 10 on it, and then two special symbols, one being Gandalf's rune and the other being the Eye of Sauron. In general, rolling the rune is a good thing. It's an automatic success, or it gives some other beneficial special result, whereas rolling Sauron's eye counts as a zero and triggers some nasty consequences.
As you would expect from any modern RPG, there are quite a few ways to modify this dice system based on character abilities and narrative positioning. Favored rolls let you roll two feat dice and keep the highest. Ill-favored rolls let you roll two and keep the lowest. Players can spend hope to roll additional success dice. Magic can be used to succeed at any test. Weariness means you can't count the ones, twos, or threes on the success dice. And when you're miserable, any Sauron's eyes rolled will result in an automatic failure.
Now, character creation in the One Ring is based on heroic cultures, and the core game includes Bardings, Dwarves of Durin's Folk, Elves of Lindon, Hobbits of the Shire, Men of Bree, and Rangers of the North. After choosing a culture, you then choose a calling. These include Captain, Champion, Messenger, Scholar, Treasure Hunter, and Warden.
So these two choices determine your attributes, your target numbers, your derived stats, standard of living, starting skills, favored skills, combat proficiencies, distinctive features, all the stuff you expect to find in a role-playing game. Now, attributes can be rolled randomly or chosen from an array, and you get lots of choices while making your character, including getting a set of starting experience you can spend to improve your initial numbers.
The characters that you make all form a company, which is, of course, fitting for a Tolkien-inspired game. You do this by selecting a patron from one of the big Middle-Earth movers and shakers like Balin, Gandalf, or my favorite, Tom Bombadil, but not the one from the movie. Choosing a safe haven, determining the group's fellowship rating, which can be spent by any company members to regain hope, and determining each character's fellowship focus, which is another character in the company that they are particularly attached to in some way.
Now, the One Ring features a pretty typical XP system based on just playing sessions of the game and not for completing specific in-game tasks. As characters level up, they improve their skills and gain rewards and virtues. There's even a full system for retiring and raising an heir.
Now, gameplay in the One Ring swaps between two phases. There's the adventuring phase, which consists of a number of scenes advancing the story. What you expect in most games. This is where all the exploration, encounters, combats, and so on happen. But at the end of each adventuring phase, there's a fellowship phase. This is where the players describe their actions between adventures. They rest, they spend experience, perhaps meet with their mentors, and set up events for their next adventuring phase.
Combat in the One Ring is very abstract as far as positioning, being mostly theater of the mind. But then it's also very tactical when it comes to mechanics. Starting with opening volleys and then moving into close quarter rounds where each combatant chooses a stance and enemies pair off in engagements. The dice system remains the same, with players losing endurance and then potentially taking wounds from damage. It's a system designed to paint combat in broad strokes, and it's not a blow-by-blow simulation.
Now, another subsystem you'll find in the One Ring are detailed rules for having a council, something that fits very well in this setting. These are used for any prolonged social encounter and can be just as tactical as a combat sequence. This is where skills like Enhearten, Persuade, Riddle, and Song take center stage.
Now, one of the most well-regarded systems in the One Ring that started with the first edition is continued in this new version is the Journey system. Of course, a huge part of Tolkien's works are about travel, journeying and exploring, And the game represents that with a detailed system where characters take on roles of guide, hunter, lookout, or scout, and through a series of roles, checks to determine how each journey goes. This has a very hex crawl feel, featuring a new journey map created during each journey, allowing the players to discover Middle-Earth along with their characters.
And of course, you can't have a Lord of the Rings game without the influence of the shadow. This is represented in the One Ring through shadow points, which can be accumulated in a number of ways, including through dread, through witnessing tragic events, by encountering the enemy, through harrowing experiences and loss of morale, and through misdeeds like violent threats, cruelty, manipulating others, and murder.
Accumulate enough shadow points and your character could experience bouts of madness and fall deeper down their chosen shadow path. Fall deep enough, and your character is lost to darkness.
Now, along with all these rules, the One Ring core book is filled with Middle-Earth lore, including a very detailed look at the region of Eriador, highlighting a ton of interesting places for players to explore, and a variety of quest and encounter hooks at each. Adversaries and companions, as well as a wealth of treasure, can be found. There's also a very dense chapter about how the game is intended to be run, and other lore master tips, with the lore master being the GM in this game.
There's also a sample adventure, The Star of the Mist, which is about an abandoned tower in the easternmost foothills of southern arid Loon, which sometimes glows with an eerie blue light.
You can also find a ton of resources on the Free League website, like PDF character sheets, journey maps, pre-generated characters, and more.
Now, what I love most about the One Ring is the fact it is clearly designed to create Tolkien-esque style stories. There are a number of mechanics here distinctly added to give you that feel of being part of Tolkien's world in the way he wrote it. Things like the council and journey rules, the rules for a company, the way wealth and treasure is completely abstracted except for very key special items, and even the entire adventure phase broken up by a fellowship phase gives things a distinct feel. This is very much not just Dungeons and Dragons set in Middle-Earth.
Yeah, I haven't read the rulebook, but we've talked about it a bunch. And from what you've told me, it definitely has a Middle-Earth feel to it, which really is what I'm looking for in a Lord of the Rings RPG.
Now, what some people may be asking is, when you're adventuring, how much of the world is open to discovery versus pre-laid out? There are a lot of hardcore Lord of the Rings fans out there who memorize all the canon. Can players memorize the world and leave nothing to surprise them? Or is there random or lore master driven aspect to adventures?
So one of the things they did that I think was extremely smart is the setting for the game is in a particular time period that is never actually documented in canon anywhere at this point. So that opens it up for you to do your own thing with the world. So while knowing exactly where the prancing pony is and how many steps it'll take you to walk to the last bridge isn't going to help anyone, because the things they know are along the way happened in a different time period, either in the past or the future. More importantly, though, this is a time period narratively. The setting for the game is a period where people don't go far from their homes. There was recently a war less than 25 years ago that isolated villages, towns, people, and landmarks, a war that involved dragons and lots of land being scorched. Now that war is done. So people have kind of buckled down. They're at peace. They settled back into their regular lives, thinking all is safe in the world again. They don't see any need to go venture over the hill. And many people have forgot what's over that hill anyway. Why would you want to go over there? It's not expected that the characters know much more than the land around where they grew up, or the farmstead they manage, or the forest they ward. Every journey in this game is expected to be an exploration and somewhat new and wondrous. The journey system set up to recreate this, so it does include a full random event system. Like, you're going to have an event every 1 to 3 hexes, depending on your roles. And these events, though, are highly narrative. This is not a D&D-style random encounter table. This is a single skill check made by a specific character based on the role they're taking in the journey and what type of event you've had. Like, don't think of this as a random combat encounter, but rather interesting things that happen between your adventure sites.
Okay, I love that focus on exploration and wonder.
Yeah, absolutely. I think this really kind of nails the feel of what Tolkien was going for in his stories in a way that most games like Pathfinder and D&D and Deathwatch don't aim for.
So the thing is, you might not want this, right? Like, this is not going to be for everyone. This could be turning off players. There might be people, you know, hitting skip on their podcatcher right now because this isn't what they want from a fantasy game. Because this is not a game about beating up the monsters to get their loot, to buy better gear, to beat up bigger monsters, to get bigger loot, to buy better gear. Nor is it a game about exploring your emotions and introspection and interpersonal relationships or getting leverage on each other. Those are all different fantasy tropes that are all valid. But this is a game about epic tales, unlikely heroes, dangerous journeys, forgotten ages, items of wondrous powers, and a steadily growing darkness.
Sounds perfectly Tolkien. Not that I don't love D&D, but not every gameplay needs to boil down to mechanics that favor murder hobos.
And in fact, this one goes in the opposite direction with that shadow increasing the more you try to murder hobo. And you're going to write your character out there if murder hobo is what you try to play in this game.
Yeah. Now, another drawback to the One Ring, though, that this is one thing, little niggling thing, is it relies on custom dice. Yes, you could play with standard dice, but it's going to be much easier to remember that sixes are special when they have an elven symbol on them, or that when you're weary, you ignore the one, two, or three when they're hollow symbols as opposed to bold. And the fact your dice D12 only actually goes from 1 to 10, and the 11 and 12 do special things. Like, it just, it's a mess having to do it. And I don't know, like what you want to do is you probably want the custom dice for this game. They are going to make it easier to play. The first edition of the game did come with the core rulebook. Unfortunately, that is no longer the case. But I still recommend pick up the starter set, because the starter set, you get a bunch of awesome stuff and you get the dice. Like, you get a full detailed book on the Shire, like block by block, and characters from the Shire and an adventure. I say, if you're not interested in that, you can just go buy the dice on their own.
And one thing to note, in early editions of the game, there were some misprinted dice, but that was corrected, and they did send out the corrected dice to people who received the incorrect ones.
Yeah, big props to Free League for handling that extremely well, actually. Now, another thing that's important when trying to decide whether or not to dive into a role-playing game is the game still supported and how much is out there? Now, for some indie gamers, you know, a one-page sheet is good for them to play for years. Other people want lots of setting information and detail and scenarios. Well, for those who care about the latter, the One Ring is still in print. And not only that, new books and supplements are being released surprisingly regularly, faster than I think I could try to keep up even if I was running this weekly. These include cool things like there is an entire way to play this role-playing game solo. There is a book called Strider Mode. You pick that up and you can play through any of their published adventures solo, which is just very cool. There are source books for various regions of Middle-Earth. There's a book that gives you a life pass system for your characters, which for people who love life pass, that's awesome. There are, of course, multiple new callings and cultures. There's adventures. And there are parts of the journey system that are hinted at in the core rulebook, like perilous sites. Well, there's a book on perilous sites that adds a whole new aspect to the journey system.
Yeah, based on the number of things they've been putting out, I don't think this one's going anywhere soon.
Yeah, now, while there are certainly ongoing, long-involved Tolkien estate-related things that do happen from time to time and continue on, Free League is a notable, significant publisher and is probably not going to do anything to anger the estate, as some companies may have in the past.
Yeah, and they're actually at this point, the state is fully on board and they've hired Tolkien experts, and like everything in these books is considered canon from what I understand, for those who care about that. Though I got to say, now that we've finally reviewed this, I expect the announcement next week that the third edition is coming. Now, the other thing I do want to call out is just how pretty this book is. It's one of those role-playing books. You're not going to want the PDF. You're going to want the physical copy. This is one of the best looking RPGs in my collection. Both inside and out. every One Ring product I own. I have more than just this book to share that same level of quality and amazing artwork. And well, if this is true of all Free League's games, Free League makes nice looking stuff. At least of all the Free League stuff I own, I think the One Ring is the best looking of all of them.
Yeah, as someone who hoards books, I appreciate the physical qualities of this book. It's beautiful. And this may sound wacky, but it has really nice paper. Like, paper quality is a thing in RPGs for me. And I'm like, it's got nice paper. I like it.
No, I mean, I personally prefer the art of Simon Stollenhag more. So my preference would probably be more towards some of the other RPGs. But again, Free League in general has just made some really quality product in all of their RPG lines that we've come across.
Now, of course, the main audience for this game is Tolkien fans, and I think that applies to fans of the books as well as the movies and the TV series. And even the old fans of the Bakshi animated movie and Rings of Power are probably going to dig this. Even fans of Lord of the Ring video games are going to find familiar tropes here. And honestly, if you are one of those people who loves just diving into Lord of the Rings lore, you might want to pick this up without even any interest in playing it, though I suggest trying the game, too.
But are there musical segues?
There are chapter headings that have some music. But more importantly, narratively, there is a huge focus on song being important in the game.
Wow. Yeah. I was just being sarcastic. I'm pleasantly shocked.
I don't think there's any new songs presented in here, but this is one of the few games where you can sing your way out of a situation mechanically.
Very cool.
Now, sorry, the hype train's not happening again. It just ran away. It's runaway train. Now, another thing I think this RPG is going to appeal to most fantasy RPG fans, especially those looking for something different from the usual fare, something different from the game currently celebrating its 50th anniversary. Even just for the curious, this is a great game to give you a look at tackling fantasy from a very different perspective than what you see in a lot of the more popular role-playing games out there.
Yeah, I think, again, as we mentioned before, the fans of games who want to be murder hobos, and to be fair, you know, there's definitely games out there that encourage that and approve of that, and that's fantastic if that's what you want to do. That's just not this game.
Overall, I am just so happy Free League sent me this. I am itching so badly. Like, I don't know if you noticed. I don't know if I was intentionally scratching, but I'm scratching. Like, 1,000 mosquito bites badly want to start up some adventures in the One Ring. While the starter set is awesome and provides a ton of games and information, it is missing some key elements that I think most RPG fans are going to want. Like, the journey and council rules are not in the starter set, and the entire shadow system is skipped. So, well, I want to say start with the starter set. I think just buy both, like pick up the starter set and this and read both, and then you can kind of mash the two together. When I run the starter set, I fully plan on using the journey rules for the characters exploring Hobbiton.
Good to know. I'm looking forward to that. That's it for our high-level look at the core book for the One Ring role-playing in the world of Lord of the Rings from Free League Publishing. A great system for recreating Tolkien-style tales at your gaming table.
There are a ton of different fantasy RPGs out there, including the venerable Dungeons & Dragons, the similar Pathfinder, more story-driven games like Dungeon World, and my personal favorite, Warhammer Fantasy Roleplay. What's your favorite fantasy RPG? Let us know in the comments below, or better yet, start a discussion over on the Tabletop Bellhop Discord at discord.tabletopbellhop.com.
Now that that journey's done, what I could really use is some more coffee, and I'm sure I'm not the only one out of the three of us. So help sense us spend our fellowship phase with a hot brew by heading to ko-fi.com/tabletopbellhop.
Did you know there's a Lord of the Rings-based exit game? Well, now you do, and you get to hear what we thought of it in a totally spoiler-free way.
Exit the game, The Lord of the Rings, Shadows Over Middle-Earth, like all of the exit games before it and probably many after it, come from the twisted minds of Inca and Marcus Brand, and is published by Cosmos, who we do have to thank for hooking us up with a review copy of this escape room game.
The box for this exit game lists it as being for 1 to 4 players, which actually seems a bit high. There's only really one puzzle you can split up the work on. We played with four, and often people were bored, and one person was trying to solve the puzzle while everyone else was just sitting there.
The component quality is good and matches what we come to expect from the exit games. This particular one had quite a few unusual objects, most of which were made of very thin cardboard, which worked well enough for what they were used for.
Now, one thing I did really like in the Lord of the Rings exit game was the unique artwork. There's lots of Middle-Earth artwork out there, and instead of using that, they hired the Miko to do all the work. And as regular listeners know, I love the Miko's work. And I especially loved his golem. I loved the golem. We should have kept the golem card when we recycled the game. I didn't realize that. We should have kept the golem card. I could have put it up on my cork board.
Exit the game, The Lord of the Rings, follows the plot of the original trilogy. It slips you into the narrative by having you play as hobbits who are working with Gandalf behind the scenes, helping out the Fellowship in ways they will never know.
Now, gameplay here is the standard exit game format, presented in a very linear fashion where you have to solve one clue before you can move on to the next. Clues are presented through a mix of a full-color booklet and cards. The answer to each clue will be a 3-digit number. That will you input onto a code wheel, which will lead you to drawing a card that, if you are correct, will lead you to draw more clues to go deeper in the book.
Now, we don't want to spoil anything here, but I will say there's a wide range of puzzles here and quite a few of them, a lot. It felt like more than previous exit games, but I might be off on that. Many of them do require you to cut, fold, and or write on game components. So not only is the game one and done as far as knowing the answers, it'd be also be very difficult to preserve this one to pass it on to someone else.
You would have to go really far out of your way to make this game replayable. I would almost say it's impossible. The puzzles here range from simple, easy to solve, to completely obtuse and totally stumping our family. We needed clues to get through two of the puzzles, though we never had to look at the final solution. And the entire game took us over 2 hours, giving us a score of only 6 out of 10.
I think we should point out that you two are not exactly Tolkien rookies or anything. Depending on when you're hearing this, you may have just in fact heard the read review of the One Ring RPG, which was completed before playing this game. So a lack of knowledge about the Tolkien history in the books is not the issue.
Yeah, but to be fair, nothing here had to be Lord of the Rings. Like, it was just another exit game from Cosmos. There were a few tie-ins, like you had to answer riddles from Gollum. And there was a clever puzzle about the gaze of Sauron. But, like, there was nothing that knowing about Middle-Earth would help at all. Like, Middle-Earth knowledge was definitely not required to this game. And, heck, I've seen some hardcore Lord of the Rings fans on BoardGameGeek comments point out exactly how at least one solution actually breaks canon.
Yeah, well, the artwork and the backstory were Lord of the Rings inspired. The puzzles were not. They were thematically tied in only the very slightest of ways. On the bright side, though, for those with no Lord of the Rings knowledge, it will not hold you back from playing this game.
So if you're looking to complete the exit series, you don't have to read the Lord of the Rings books before you play this one.
True. Yeah, the biggest problem here was some puzzles felt more frustrating than clever, even after learning the answers. The box gives this one a difficulty of 2 out of 5. I've got to say, I found this to be one of the harder exit games we played.
Yeah, I found this game frustrating and frankly unfun. The puzzles weren't really tied to the theme. They were abstract. It's sometimes very vague. I think the best spoiler-free way I can describe it is that many times we would come up with two equally viable solutions, and then from there we were just guessing.
Yeah, and that's tough. When you can come up with multiple solutions, that's a concerning aspect of these.
Though I do have to say one of the benefits of the exit system is you are not punished for making a wrong guess, as you are in many of the other games. And this is not an app-driven game. There is an app. You can get an app, and it'll give you a timer with some sound effects. But you are punished for how long you take and if you use clues, though, for your final score. I don't know. As a Lord of the Rings game, I was hoping for more interesting story, maybe some new pieces of lore, or canon, or I don't know, at least headcanon, or even some bad fanfic. It just followed our preceded the Fellowship and solved unrelated puzzles, just didn't do it for me. I would have much preferred a completely unrelated tale that wasn't tied to the actual events of Lord of the Rings, maybe happening at the same time. Or if they're going to follow the books, maybe not follow them step by step. I'd say more, but I think any example I gave would spoil at least some of it.
In the storyline, if I remember correctly, they referred to our group as a second fellowship. Like, the game expects you to be a group when you're playing it, yet those puzzles were some of the least group-friendly puzzles I have ever played. And like, each one needed to be held up closely by one person at a time to solve it. And not just because I have crappy eyes. The kids were having, the same sort of thing. It's just stuff you had to pick up, manipulate, look at closely. Only one person can really be doing it at a time. It did not feel like a group activity.
Yeah, unfortunately, while we have been fans of the Exit series in general, it appears that the thematic versions are a little less solid than the more, I don't want to say generic, but non-IP related Exit games.
Yeah, overall, Exit the game, Lord of the Rings, Shadows over Middle-Earth was just a disappointment for us. I think I would have liked it well enough if it didn't say Lord of the Rings, if it was just some fantasy escape room game. But putting Lord of the Rings on this just made me expect more. More in terms of story and more in terms of thematic tie-in. Heck, you didn't even get a plastic ring tchotchke in the box at the end to keep at the end.
Yeah, and maybe that's the problem here. Maybe I'm being too hard on the game because I had the bar in my head set too high. I was so excited to do a Lord of the Rings themed escape room game. And this was more like an escape room game with some Lord of the Rings artwork.
Yeah, it's tough, especially the more escape room games we do, and the range of escape room games, from the very high end wooden boxes back down to 18 cards in a deck escape rooms. Trying to find the right balance and the right expectations for each of them is very difficult, and sometimes putting your IP on something changes those expectations more than you might think.
Now, if you do love the Exit series of games from the brands and Cosmos, you'll probably want to pick this up if you haven't already. It really does fit the mold of their games, and it does impress me how they keep coming up with new puzzles. The brands have to be brilliant. Like, I don't know how they keep coming up with new ways to use these small boxes, and there was definitely stuff in this game I'd never seen before. So props to them for this, for that.
If you like the Exit games, you'll probably enjoy this one. I mean, I enjoy the Exit series. I think of all the ones that we played, this one would score the lowest for me, but it doesn't stop me from wanting to play the next Exit game we happen to run into.
One thing you didn't mention, what was the kids' overall feeling? How did they walk away from it? Less. Okay. That says
no, it all right there. No, I was waiting for D to talk. I didn't want to talk.
I think, again, I set the bar too high because I was like, guys, this is going to be fantastic. We're going to play a Lord of the Rings game. It's A, and that's awesome. B, it's going to be an Exit game. We all love Exit games. And we just made the kids sit through the Lord of the Rings movies to prep them for playing this game so they would be fully bought in. We were just a little too excited about it.
Yeah, and the one problem, we didn't quite get through all of Return of the King. Because Gwen has, like, you put a TV on in front of her and she passes out in about half an hour. So it was split over multiple nights. And Jem was disappointed because there's spoilers if you don't know Lord of the Rings. Not that I feel Lord of the Rings really needs a spoiler warning. It's been around for a very long time. But for anyone who does care about that, this will completely spoil the movies. I don't know. If you aren't an Exit game fan, if you tried them before and are like, nah, I didn't really like them, this one's not going to win you over. Like, of all the ones we played, this is my least favorite Exit game. For the same reason, I definitely don't recommend this as your first Exit game experience, which is where I think Cosmos might have faltered a bit here, because I think by throwing the license on it, they probably got a lot of new people to check out the series, and I really don't think it's the best example. I think this would have been even more hard, if not impossible without using clues, if we didn't have some idea of the tricks the brands like to put into their games.
Yeah, I think in order to play this game, you just had to understand the concept of the exit game. And if you didn't have that going in, you probably have a less enjoyable experience.
For Lord of the Rings fans, you can skip this, really. Unless you're a total completionist and need every Tolkien-inspired game out there, there's nothing new for you to experience here. Though I guess if you really want Miko's take on Middle-Earth, you get to see that.
So at this point, the ring is destroyed and our hobbit helpers are exhausted from their ordeal. It's time for a rest, or maybe that's the second breakfast bell. While they put their hairy feet up for a bit, I want to know, what is your favorite Lord of the Rings game? Tell us about it in the comments or hit us up on social media, anywhere under Tabletop Bellhop, one word, pretty much everywhere.
Now, what better way to relax than to put on a comfy new outfit and grab a cup of your favorite brew? And now you can do both and rep the Bellhop brand with a 15-ounce Bellhop mug and one of our great-looking and fitting t-shirts. Just head to tabletopbellhop.com/merch. For a limited time, buy any two items, like I said, a t-shirt and a mug, and get free shipping up to $25.
Earn your place in the Celtic Otherworld in Tir na n'Og, a mathy tableau builder featuring a cool theme and fantastic artwork.
Tir na n'Og comes from the team of Isaac Shalev and J6 Slingerlin and features artwork from Merlis Brendis and Bridget Indelicato. It's being published by our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild, after a successful Kickstarter and should be found on store shelves soon. I don't have the exact street date here, but we do know you can pick up a copy at Origins Game Fair later this month, and it's already available on the Grand Gamers Guild website.
This abstract card game plays 1 to 5 players, and it works well at all player counts. While the box lists playing time is under an hour, every game that we've played, except for solo ones, has gone longer than that due to AP or analysis paralysis.
Yeah, there's a lot to think about in this game with lots of options, which is probably where the age recommendation of 13 plus comes from. We think you could go lower than that, though, as the mechanics are not that complicated. It's just the variety of options that really makes up the game's weight.
So in Celtic Mist, Tir na n'Og is the other world, the realm of the Fae. In this game, the path to the other world has opened again, and players will be sending storytellers on journeys, drafting cards representing the adventures they had, and using those to build the saga while trying to complete their 3 Geshe, or destinies. Now, mechanically, you will be drafting cards from a grid by first placing your storytellers between 2 cards, then drafting from the cards you've selected and placing them into a 3-row tableau, left to right. Each row has its own scoring system, and you also get bonus points at the end for collecting groups of cards in the same color.
Earlier this month, I tossed up an Instagram reel where we did a quick unboxing of Tir na n'Og. So you can check that out to get a look at what you get with the Smith-based game. You can find a link in the show notes.
So component quality here is good, but there is a lot of air in that box. The game could have come in a box 1/4 this size. Now, we do know that there is an expansion coming for this game. The cards currently have icons on them that aren't actually used without that expansion, so there may be a chance that the box is big enough to fit the expansion, but we don't know for sure.
Now, what you do get in this oversized box are some really solid playing pieces. Cardboard counters that are clear and easy to read, oversized Geshe cards, and a deck of adventure cards. Card quality is good, and the rulebook is clear and concise.
The only complaint we have, component-wise, is that the Geshe cards could be a little clearer and the examples on them could be significantly better. We even spotted some cards where the math was wrong. The important thing to know here is to always go with the text on the cards and not the pictures.
So to start a game of Tir na n'Og, everyone starts the playing grabs the playing pieces in their color. The group decides which Geshe cards to use, selecting 1 top card, 1 middle card, and 1 bottom card. Everyone starts with a hand of 5 cards, and you build an initial grid of story cards on the table, the size of which is based on the player count. Each story card has a value from 0 to 8 and comes in 1 of 4 elements represented by a color.
So starting with the player who last told the story, players place one of their storyteller markers on an open spot between 2 cards. The other players follow in clockwise order until each player has placed 3 storytellers.
Now, in the same order, players each draft 1 of the cards that one of their storytellers is touching, taking the card into their hand and removing the storyteller. If Because of other folks drafting cards, it ends up that a storyteller is no longer touching any cards. They are considered lost in the other world. And then, after everyone else has finished drafting, any lost storytellers get to select any one leftover card.
Every time you draft a card from the table, you must then immediately play a card into your tableau next to one of your three Gesh cards. Cards must be placed from left to right, but can go into any of the three rows. In general, though, only a maximum of five cards in each row.
Now, Sean says in general because this is an exception-based card game. About half of the cards in the deck have special abilities on them. These break the rules in a number of different ways. Their value can change based on other cards in your tableau. You can swap or remove cards, or they can let you place your storytellers in new ways, like at the corner of four cards instead of two, and more.
After each player has drafted and then played three cards, the round ends. Remaining cards in the other world are discarded, and every player discards one card from their hand. Start player then passes to the left, and a new grid of cards is laid out.
This continues for a total of five rounds, with players drafting and playing exactly 15 cards each. At the end of the fifth round, players will look at their completed tableau, their personal epic saga, and score it based on the Gesh cards chosen at the beginning of the game.
So each Gesh card scores in a different way, like many include special placement rules as well for the cards in the row. These include things like add up your even cards and your odd cards, but score the lowest total between the two, or getting points for having matching colors of cards in the same column, or start with 25 points and subtract a point for every card placed, but don't count duplicates, or score the value of every card, but they have to be placed lowest to highest, and so on.
After players have calculated their points for completing their Geshes, you then score for elements, which are sets of matching colored cards orthogonally adjacent to each other. You get points for having the most, second most, or third most of a color, and the actual points are based on the player count.
Total everything up, and the player with the most points wins. The game also includes a solo mode where you complete against an AI opponent that plays very smoothly and quickly. They get a set number of points depending on the Gesh cards you choose to use, and then also compete for color majority at the end. Now, warning, this AI is tough to beat, as they tend to score the Gesh as if they missed the maximum points by only one or two cards.
Now, the big thing people need to know about Tir na n'Og is it's a mathy game, and that's going to be the biggest deciding factor on people like it or not. While this game has a great theme, very cool artwork, and some thematic tie-in with card abilities, in the end, it's all about building a grid of number cards, following a randomized set of rules, and scoring opportunities with additional points scored for completing sets of the same color. It's thinky, and there are a lot of options every turn, and it's going to cause AP in most players, even those who don't normally spend a lot of time thinking when playing games.
Yeah, I feel like if I'm going to play Math the Game, and don't get me wrong, I really dig this game, but if I'm going to play Math the Game, I might as well play it with some pretty artwork and Celtic folktale tie-ins. Like, the theming actually sold this one for me. It made me be excited about getting it to the table, and once I got it to the table, I loved it.
Yeah, after playing it myself, I think Mo summed it up very well in his initial overview when he described this as a game that could have been made by Rainer Nitzer. It wasn't. But it's very much that kind of game.
Yeah, note the math here isn't hard. It's basic addition and subtraction and maybe some multiplication by numbers less than 10. But it can get complicated if you have multiple cards whose values is based on the other cards in your tableau. Now, thankfully, the game provides counters to show what value variable cards have, as well as tokens for showing if a card changes color. I know in one game, every time I added a single card to my top row, it affected three other cards in my tableau. In the last round, it took me a long time to figure out my best option on where to play. This game has a very puzzle, deduction, logic puzzle kind of feel.
Yeah, and I do love that you don't have to keep track of any of those variable cards, like either in your own tableau or across the table in someone else's. Those markers are super useful, and I think they actually help with the game flow.
Now, with players who know what they're getting into, Tir na n'Og has been a hit so far, a big hit. My family digs the deduction and puzzle style game, so this was right up our alley. Now, while I do wish there was something a little bit more thematic happening, I do love the game for what it is. I have enjoyed every play of Tir na n'Og, and I'm looking forward to more.
Now, I think for me, based on the tone and theme, I want this to be a little more light and casual. It's a game about fae and mysticism, yet in order to play, you need to be fixated on details, calculating various options, and doing math, as well as working to block and steal cards to prevent your opponents from achieving their goals.
Okay, I will agree. I like the theme. I'm a sucker for fairy tales and folklore, and the artwork is pretty. But it does feel like one of the most insert theme here games that we've played in a long while. And the theme and the mechanics don't quite gel. That said, I still hold that if I'm going to play Math the Game, you might as well make it pretty folktale Math the Game.
Now, one thing that does keep me looking forward to playing again and diving into this game even further is the different gash cards. Even playing with each set in the game once is going to take some time. And then you have all the possible combinations between the different tops, bottoms, and middles. And I also dig the fact the game did include a first set, good for learning the game. It doesn't feature any of the more complicated calculations.
Yeah, there's a ton of variables here. Lots of replay value. This is not a game that's going to get stale quickly.
Now, another detail about this game, and something you might want to think about when teaching or playing the game, is that if you misread something, you might as well not play. Skip or misunderstand one word, and you're done. This is not a forgiving game. I would recommend going through those gash cards very clearly and making sure that everyone understands the end game scoring before you get started.
Yeah, this is big. Honestly, really big. Some of the wording on the gash cards could be a little better. And as noted earlier, some of the examples on them are actually wrong. Reading through each of the three gash cards, your top, middle, or the bottom, before you start, using each of them before anyone places a storyteller can be very important. You need to make sure everyone is on the same page and make sure they're clear for everyone, because it is not fun to realize partway through a game that you've been building your tableau completely wrong.
Yeah, and we've managed to mess this up multiple times. Even just last night, I was playing a solo game where I had misread one of the gash cards. Mo happened to stop by to watch my solo game and said, "Wait, why are you playing a seven there? What are you doing?" And I looked and he explained to me what I was doing wrong, and I was so frustrated, I scrapped the game and started over again because...
Yeah, and unfortunately, when I was doing something about three quarters of the way through the game, I realized that I had missed lowest in one word in my top gash card, which crushed the scoring for that entire row.
Overall, I really dig Tir na n'Og. It's a great card drafting, math-heavy set collection tableau builder. As a 1 to 5 player abstract strategy game, this is fantastic. You usually don't get games with this feel that work so well with up to 5 players. A lot of those Nidzia games are, 2-3 players. That's where they're best. Where it does fail for me, though, is fulfilling the storytelling promise, right? Like, not only is it about the Celtic Feywild, it's about sending storytellers to the Feywild and the other realms. Like where is that? My tableau of different colored cards doesn't feel like an epic tale at the end. It just feels like a set of cards and getting points for doing it well.
Yeah, I love this game. It's one of my favorites that I've played so far in 2024. But don't go into this expecting epic storytelling and tight thematic tie-ins. You will be disappointed.
It's Math the Game, and it's a great math game. But it is a math game, not a fae game.
Yeah. Now, if you do dig abstract strategy games and mathy games, this is great. Go get it. If you're a fan of Nitzia style games, you're going to love Tir na n'Og. Just watch out for that AP. If you've got an entire group of math heavy gamers who like this kind of thing, you might sit there staring at the cards a little more than double the time in the box. Because I got to say, trying to figure out the optimal move every time does sometimes take time.
Oh, I will say solo play is great if you're AP prone. You can take as long as you want, as long as you manage to clear the table in time for dinner.
Fair. Now, if you are looking for a storytelling game about Celtic myths, you aren't going to find that in Tir na n'Og. While each gash card does have a story on the back, and the cards are all mythological places, heroes, and characters, none of that really matters. You are drafting and placing cards for their numbers or abilities, not because you are telling a tale of Cuchulainn.
And that drafting mechanic, I really love it. The way that you place your storyteller between two cards, and then other people place theirs, and then you come around and you are going to be able to only get one of those two cards, and it's based on what other people have played. Like, there's a lot of variables that go in there for bluffing and for having to adapt your strategy that I really enjoy.
For everyone else, you probably have already made up your mind if this game's right for you or not. Like, I think our description of it's pretty clear and gives you a really good idea of how the game feels and plays. But I do recommend give this game a shot. As I said, our family is into deduction games and logic puzzles, that type of game. So I knew it was going to be perfect for some of the people we play with. But honestly, it won over a couple I wasn't so sure would dig it. Just make sure you do sit down and play it. Everyone knows what they're getting into. Don't, like, when I put this on our menu for one of our local public play events, the first time I did it, it was like, Journey to the Celtic Feywild to do this and this. And Nia's like, no, you got to change that because you are going to get people trying to play this game that are expecting something completely different than what you just alluded to. Now, I'm a fan of mathy games, and that's part of why Tir na n'Og was a hit for me. What's a math-heavy game you enjoy? Leave a comment wherever you found this review and let us know what your favorite mathy game is.
Well, I've done the math, and it tells me it's time to promote our newsletter. Head over to tabletopbellhop.com and click on Get Our Newsletter. Mo sends out one of these each week, which gives you links to all of the content that we've published in the last week, a heads up on our next podcast recording, and a gaming or game night tip or two.
Well, that was the double bell.
That means our shift's coming to an end, and we're going to have to lock the lobby doors. Get out.
Before we start locking things down, let's take a moment to thank a few of our Tabletop Bellhop Patreon patrons.
Kat and Tori Dome, looking forward to you both playing Hobbits sometime soon.
Jeff and Sheila Seuss.
Thank you to Brian Kurtz.
Another Brian, Brian Van Beek. Thank you, Brian.
William Fisher, thank you.
Andrew Dacey. Thank you, Andrew.
Well, your first stop to finding us should be at tabletopbellhop.com, but we're all over the web as Tabletop Bellhop, one word, and on your podcatcher of choice as the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast.
Hear your name on the show by supporting us at patreon.com/tabletopbellhop. There you can also get access to our pre-production show notes, sausage-making blog posts, first thoughts, reviews, and more. Actually, I just shared my first thoughts on Point City today.
The other thing you can do to show your support is to give us a thumbs up, a like, or better yet, tell your friends and fellow gamers about the show. That's it for tonight.
For Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast, I'm Sean.
I'm Deanna.
And I'm Mo.
Thank you. And game on. Game on.